If I asked you the question, could you put your hand up if you're a full-time Christian minister? Could you put your hand up if you're a full-time Christian minister? I'm just waiting for the penny to drop here. Yeah, it's gradually dropping. I can see it dropping through the congregation. Now, we talk about full-time Christian ministry as though it's something that people like myself and Warren do. I'm no more a full-time Christian minister than you are. And in the way that I'm no more a priest than you are. God calls us all, as you were saying. Our lives are consecrated, every part and aspect of life.
This is GBC Web TV. On the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspiring biblical teaching and other excellent Christian videos. You can order the teaching video DVDs, listen to and study the audio versions of these, or download them as audio podcasts to your computer or MP3 player. Today's inspiring and biblical teaching is called Priests, Exodus chapter 29, verses 1 to 46, by Pastor David Wise.
We have been on Sunday mornings, not every Sunday morning, but most Sunday mornings when I've been here. We've been working our way through the book of Exodus, and we find ourselves today looking at Exodus chapter 29. And if you're here for the first time, just a few things to say. The book of Exodus and the events that are narrated in it is probably the most significant part of the Old Testament. It's foundational to everything that follows in the Old Testament, and it is foundational to the New Testament as well. And what we're going to see this morning as we look at this passage, we are unusually today, I don't usually do this, but we're going to be moving backwards and forwards from the Old Testament to the New, because this passage is so important in understanding God's intention for us, you and me, here today. Last time, which was 2 weeks ago, we spent some time, we looked at chapters 27 and 28, and we were looking at the altar. And we were looking at the clothing that the priests wear in a, you can see it on the internet, it's called Dressed for God. And now, if you were here 2 weeks ago, it's revision time for a moment. What are the key things that 2 weeks ago, because it leads into the passage we're looking at this morning. When we looked 2 weeks ago at chapters 27 and 28, what were the key things that we learned? What were the key things we took away from that 2 weeks ago? Can you remember? Can you cast your mind back 2 weeks? You can have a quick flick at the chapter, see if it reminds you. Some of you, of course, weren't here 2 weeks ago, so you can just look, sit and look really smug now as other people work on this. So what were the main things from 2 weeks ago? Wow, that's impressive. Rangina, I'm really pleased you're here.
No coincidences with God.
No coincidences with God.
Things happened in the past, but I don't know why. But
okay, that was something from a previous week. It wasn't 2 weeks ago, but is one of the things we looked at. But that's an even better memory, because that goes back even slightly further. What about 2 weeks ago, Dorothy?
God not only cares for your outside, but inside as well.
Yeah, God cares not just for the outside, but for the inside, yeah. What else did we see 2 weeks ago? What were the key other key things that we saw something about sin. Do you remember? We spent a long time. Steve, were you about to say something? Or were you... Okay, all right. You weren't here 2 weeks ago. Yes.
Sin blocks the access to God.
Exactly the words I've got here. Look, sin blocks access to God. That's very good. We looked at how serious sin was. And in our sort of, sometimes in our culture, you know, our sort of charismatic, what some of us call happy clappy culture, we forget how serious sin is. And we were just reminded us last time as we looked at that sin is really serious and sin blocks our access to God. And we learned something about ourselves as well last time. When we looked at the priest's clothing, It's not that we have to dress up as the priest dressed up, but there was something important we saw about ourselves, which does lead into what we're doing today. Lorraine.
That God is interested in the minor details of our lives.
Yeah, God's interested in the minor details. That wasn't last time. That was actually the week before, but that's very, very good. Yeah.
That we are all priests.
We are all priests, yes. We looked about the fact that in the Old Testament, there was just this group of priests. It was always God's intention to have a nation of priests. But in the Old Testament, there was just this group of priests. But we looked at the fact that we are priests. We today, we're going to look at it again in a few minutes' time. And that we have roles in helping people find their way to God. And we all have a role in that. So that's from last time. So let's begin with chapter 29. And we're going to work through the whole chapter this morning. And to say to you, if you're here for the first time, one of the things that I'll be doing as I go through, I'm going to be stopping and we're going to be asking some questions and talking about some of these things together as we work to apply this into our lives. It's really important when we look at Scripture, when we read the Bible, that we understand what it means for us today in how we live our lives today. So we're going to be working on that. What does this mean for us today? What does it mean for me as tomorrow, for you tomorrow as you go to work or as you take the kids to school or as you go back to college or whatever it is that you're doing? What does it mean for you in that context? And just to remind you that this whole passage that we're looking at, we are listening into a conversation. You won't pick that up just from here, but if you go back a few chapters, we're listening into a conversation. This is happening on the top of Mount Sinai. And there is one human being in this conversation, Moses, and one divine being, God. And we are listening to God speaking to Moses. So we are, it's one of these like fly on the wall bits of the Bible. There are several of them where, you know, it's a record of a conversation that went on in private. And this is what went on between God and Moses up on the top of the mountain. So all of this is God speaking. This is what you are to do to consecrate them so that they may serve me as priests. This is verse 1 of chapter 29. Take a young bull and two rams without defect, and from fine wheat flour without yeast, make bread and cakes mixed with oil and wafers spread with oil. Put them in a basket and present them in it, along with the bull and the two rams. Then bring Aaron and his sons to the entrance to the tent of meeting and wash them with water. Take the garments and dress Aaron with the tunic, the robe of the ephod itself and the breastpiece. Fasten the ephod on him by its skillfully woven waistband. Put the turban on his head and attach the sacred diadem to the turban. You may remember that said, "Holy to the Lord." Take the anointing oil and anoint him by pouring it on his head. Bring his sons and dress them in tunics and put headbands on them. Then tie sashes on Aaron with his sons. The priesthood is theirs by lasting ordinance. In this way you shall ordain Aaron and his sons. Now we're not going to look at the clothing this week because we did all of that 2 weeks ago. So if you want to find out, you weren't here 2 weeks ago, want to find out the significance of these bits of clothing, go to the website and Dressed for God is the title you need to listen to. I want to remind you of a passage I quoted last time as well. It's from 1 Peter. I just want to read it to you. 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 5. So this is Peter writing to the New Testament church. This is God speaking to us. So you are being addressed by this, okay? If you're here this morning, put your hand up. If you're here, put your hand up. I'm glad you've realized you're here, Andy. That's very impressive. So this is being addressed to you, okay? You also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. And verse 9, you, it's everyone that put their hand up, you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. It was God's intention to create priests, priests that could be there between people that don't know God and God himself. In the Old Testament, there was this class of priests, but in the New Testament, if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, you are a priest. That's what the Bible says. No special priest. I'm no more a priest. I'm an ordained Baptist minister. That doesn't make me one little bit more of a priest than you are. If you're a priest, put your hand up. Yeah, we are all priests. And I want you to have that in mind as we look through this passage this morning, because this is about God's intention for these Old Testament priests. But actually, it is God's intention for us, the principles behind it, not the details here. Now, we haven't got to have, as you'll see, blood put on our earlobes and big toes and so on. But the principles are the same. The primary concern in this chapter is how sinful human beings can become priests for the living God. That's what this is about, how sinful human beings can become priests for the living God. And, you know, without meaning to be too personal, all of you here who put your hands up to say that you were priests are sinful human beings. So this is what we're learning about. How do sinful human beings become priests? How do they operate? Priests are people that actually God meets people through priests. So how does this happen? That's what this chapter is about. That's what we're going to be reflecting on this morning. And also what it means, what we do in terms of this role. So in verse 4, for example, we've got the very beginning of this. Aaron and his sons, they're brought to the tent of meeting, to the tabernacle, and they are washed with water. First thing that happens, they're washed with water. Now, a lot of people draw that parallel between that and something in the New Testament. Baptism, right at the beginning, first thing before anything else, baptism. In the New Testament, as soon as someone became a Christian, they were baptized. It just so happens that next Sunday, we have a baptismal service here. I mention that because there may be some of you who are sitting here this morning who have made some sort of response to God, maybe in some way, but you've never been baptized. Next Sunday morning is your next opportunity to make that response to God. And it's something we do at the beginning of our life. It's not that we wait till we reach some point of perfection or some place where we've got it all sorted. In the New Testament, the moment someone's converted, they're baptized. That's how it ought to be. So if you've accepted Jesus in your life, you are ready for baptism. And next Sunday is your next opportunity. If you want to talk some more about that, you talk to me after the meeting has finished this morning. Baptism symbolizes total cleansing, a washing away of sin, total cleansing. So that's the first part here, cleansing. The second thing, in verse 7, is anointing. Take the anointing oil and pour it and anoint him by pouring it on his head. So cleansing first of oil, anointing second. Now anointing is about someone being chosen and set apart for a specific task or role. We talk about Jesus Christ. The word Christ means anointed. And we are known as Christians. The word Christian means little Christ. So as Christians, we are little anointed ones. We are set apart for serving God. We are set apart for ministry. So washed, anointed, and then in verse 9, it talks about the word there, ordain, is an odd word. It literally means to fill someone's hands. What is that about? It's come over into English. We might say of Louise. Louise has got lots of children. She has got her hands full. Yeah? I don't mean to pick on you, just you're sitting in the front row, you know. She's got her hands full. So it's this idea of having something put in your hands that gives you stuff to do. It's about God giving you, you know, hands full. So just before we move on into the next section, let's think for a moment. What can we learn about ourselves then from this passage? I mean, there is more than I've just pulled out the really obvious things, but there are other things as well here. What do we learn from this passage? There is a great parallel to this elsewhere in the New Testament as well, one that I've not referred to yet. So what are the things that we learn from this passage about ourselves today? God's intention for us as priests. What are the key things? Well, I can hear those cogs turning. Yes, Hannah.
That we present ourselves as a living sacrifice.
We present ourselves as a living sacrifice. They're going to do that in a moment, actually, in this passage. We're going to come to that in a few moments. Very good.
And also that we are a royal priesthood.
We are a royal priesthood. Royal priesthood. Steve.
We are a temple.
We're a temple. What does that mean? What's a temple about?
It's a vessel holding something inside it.
So there's two things about a temple. Temple is actually somewhere where God dwells. And people that go to the temple to meet with God. Okay. So if we are a temple, it means that you are a place that people who want to meet God can come to. You are the place. I've used this phrase before. We are the place. The temple is the place where heaven touches earth. We, as this royal priesthood, with these stones being built into a living temple, we are the place where heaven touches earth. So for people around you tomorrow, wherever you are tomorrow, think where you're going to be at 10 o'clock tomorrow. Don't tell me. Just think where you're going to be at 10 o'clock tomorrow morning. At that time, 10 o'clock tomorrow morning, and before and after, of course, you are a living temple for those people who are around you at 10 o'clock tomorrow morning. You are the place where heaven touches earth. Thank you. What else from these first 9 verses? Joy.
Just about keeping a short account with God. So, you know, asking God to forgive you and to, like the priests were washed, ask forgiveness to be washed by grace.
So continually, you know, when we do things that are wrong, and none of us are perfect, we all do things that are wrong, it's about asking God's forgiveness and staying clean. Yes, I saw a hand. Timmy. Oh, sorry, I'll come back to you.
Being a priest requires a preparation to serving God. It requires us to essentially put away the old things and be what he wants us to.
That's very important. This whole image we have in the New Testament, don't we, of taking off the sinful life it's talked about, and putting on Christ. These people here, literally, everything was taken off, they were washed, and then they were clothed with the new garments that were given to them by God. God had designed, God had explained exactly what they were to look like, and as we saw last time, they got all sorts of significance to them. So it's the taking off of everything of old, the washing, and the putting on of the new, and it's about that getting ready to serve. So if we're going to be effective priests, that needs to be our experience. The old has gone, the new has come. Yeah? Thank you.
As the temple of God, the body as the temple of God must be kept clean and holy.
Yeah, God's temple, which we are, needs to be kept clean and holy. Very good. Let's go on then. Let's look at the next section. Verse 10. Bring the bull to the front of the tent of meeting, and Aaron and his sons shall lay their hands on its head. Slaughter it in the Lord's presence at the entrance to the tent of meeting. Take some of the bull's blood and put it on the horns of the altar with your finger, and pour out the rest of it at the base of the altar. Then take all the fat around the inner parts, the covering of the liver, both kidneys, and the fat around them, and burn them on the altar. But burn the bull's flesh and its hide and its offal outside the camp. It is a sin offering. Now, with this sin offering, what is happening here? It's about the animal is brought, and the priests or whoever is making the sin offering lay their hand on the animal. And laying hand on is about identification with in this context. And it's saying, this is me. And that animal is then killed. And it is saying, actually, this is what I deserve. This is what I deserve. I deserve this because of the sin in my life. This animal is dying in my place. Notice that the sin offering is actually, it's the only one of the offerings, it's burnt outside the camp. It's taken outside and it's burnt. It's a sin offering. And a number of people have drawn a parallel here with Jesus' death. That perfect sin offering. Because he was taken outside the camp, outside the city, to be crucified. As that perfect sin offering, which we're going to read about in Hebrews a little bit later on. So there is that parallel there that many have seen. Now listen to this. Picture this as we read this. Picture this in your minds, okay? And I might actually invite you, I mean, you might think this is a bit disgusting. So, you know, if you think it's disgusting, well, okay, it's disgusting. I want you to imagine that you are one of the priests. I want to you to imagine, as we go through this, that, you know, you've been there, you've been washed, you've been dressed in this stuff, and then this is what happens next. And I want you to imagine that this is you, and think about how it feels, what is going on here. Okay, you up for that? It's a bit, you know, if you don't like blood, I'm afraid, here we go. Verse 15. Take one of the rams, and Aaron and his sons shall lay their hands on its head. Slaughter it, and take the blood, and sprinkle it against the altar on all sides. Cut the ram into pieces. Wash the inner parts and the legs, putting them with the head and the other pieces. Then burn the entire ram on the altar. It is a burnt offering to the Lord, a pleasing aroma, an offering made to the Lord by fire. Take the other ram, and Aaron and his sons shall lay their hands on its head. Slaughter it. Got your imagination here now? Take some of the blood and put it on the lobes of the right ears of Aaron and his sons, on the thumbs of their right hands, and on the big toes of their right feet. Then sprinkle blood against the altar on all sides, and take some of the blood on the altar and some of the anointing oil and sprinkle it on Aaron and on his garments and on his sons and their garments. Then he and his sons and their garments will be consecrated. Now, all of this sounds a bit odd, but it is hugely significant. In fact, it's already been referred to. Somebody this morning made the comment. I've got a quote here. It's from one of the writers that I read when I'm preparing the teaching on Exodus, from a guy called Motya. He writes this: the hand, life's actions; the foot, life's direction; and first and foremost the ear, life's listening, the hearing of divine truth, must be brought under the blood. The whole thing about the right thumb and the right hand and the right earlobe is they were seen as the side of strength. I won't go into the whole reasoning for that, but that's the imagery that is there. So blood is taken and put on the right thumb, the big toe on the right foot, the right earlobe. Life's actions, life's direction, and life's listening is consecrated and given to God. And this is about the whole of their lives being dedicated to serving God forever. They were actually being presented as a living sacrifice. That sounds familiar, doesn't it? Romans chapter 12. But that's the image here. They are being presented as a living sacrifice, a public statement that they would willingly serve God forever. Hands, feet, ears. Actions, directions, listening. That's everything in life, isn't it? Actions, direction, listening. Consecrated to God. Take from this ram, verse 22, the fat tail, the fat around the inner parts with the covering of the liver, both kidneys with the fat around them, the right thigh. This is the ram for the ordination. From the basket of bread made without yeast, which is before the Lord, take a loaf and put a cake made with oil and the wafer. Put all of these in the hands of Aaron and his sons and wave them before the Lord as a wave offering. We still do this actually in some churches today when they are consecrating gifts. They will do it with the offering sometimes. They're praying. They lift it before God as a sign of saying, this is yours. Same principle here. So they're taking an offering and they are lifting it before God. And it's a way of saying, this is consecrated. This is given over to God. Take them from their hands and burn them on the altar along with the burnt offering for a pleasing aroma to the Lord, an offering made to the Lord by fire. After you take the breast of the ram for Aaron's ordination, wave it before the Lord as a wave offering, and it will be your share. It's not burnt, it's not sacrificed, it's given to the priests for them to eat. It is their share. So let's think back then over these verses, verses 10 to 28. Think about ourselves. Think about our lives this week. What do we learn from here that helps us understand our role as priests today? How does this, what do we learn from this? How does it come into our lives today? Keep thinking. I see a hand. I don't know whose hand it is, but I see a hand at the back there. Birch.
Yes. To me, this just implies that God, with God, everything is possible. And he used the simple to do extraordinary things.
Everything is possible with God, and he uses just the simple to do extraordinary things. Yeah, what else? Anita.
Everything we own belongs to God. Everything of this is loaned to us temporarily in this world. We came in with the world with nothing, and we go out the world with nothing. And he wants us to live righteous and holy lives before him.
Okay, everything we have belongs to God. He wants us to use that in a holy way. Yes, what else? What else? Steve.
Linking it to the blood on your right hand, right side, and listening to God. We need to be listening to God and putting action towards it as well.
Okay, so we today as priests, we need to be listening to God and then doing it with our hands and with our feet, yeah? But it's a very strong image, isn't it? You know, we talk sometimes about, you know, our life being consecrated to God. And I think sometimes we don't think about what that means. We say it really lightly and flippantly. Oh, you know, Jesus is Lord of my life. Well, just think about this. This is, you know, the foot, the hand, the ear. I mean, it's standing for every part of life, given over, permanently consecrated to God. And this is Old Testament. How much more for us? This is what God asks of us. This is what God asks of us. Anything else? Yeah, boss say.
Where half of the bits of the hand said, look, this is your share.
Yeah.
It shows the generosity of God. We can never outgive to God.
Okay, so it's God's generosity towards us, yeah? Very good. Something else there as well, actually. Andy?
Yeah, something about the fact that when we say that we're consecrated, it's almost like, that's it, we don't have to do anything else, and it's all been done for us, and we can just sit back and enjoy life. But there's something about that and the whole ordination thing that suggests otherwise, that we have a huge responsibility to walk as Christ, and also we have a purpose. The whole ordination thing is the fact that we do have, and we should have a purpose in the things that we're doing, as we listen to God, as we look for direction, and so on. that we have a purpose.
Yeah, we have purpose all, yeah, so there's that whole purpose. And if I asked you the question, could you put your hand up if you're a full-time Christian minister? Could you put your hand up if you're a full-time Christian minister? I'm just waiting for the penny to drop here. Yeah, it's gradually dropping. I can see it dropping through the congregation. Now, we talk about full-time Christian ministry as though it's something that people like myself and Warren do. I'm no more a full-time Christian minister than you are. And in the way that I'm no more a priest than you are. God calls us all, as you were saying. Our lives are consecrated, every part and aspect of life. For some, there is, some have to, you know, earn their money in other employment. For some, there is provision of the ram's breast, as it's talked about here, which you find, again, a principle throughout, that there are some people that God calls to serve him and to be fed and supported by others who are part of the family of God. But actually, we're all called to full-time Christian ministry. Doesn't mean we're all paid by the church, but we're all called, we're all equally full-time Christian ministers. Full-time Christian priests. Okay, let's go on to the next section, verse 29. Aaron's sacred garments will belong to his descendants so they can be anointed and ordained in them. The son who succeeds him as priest and comes to the tent of meeting to minister in the holy place is to wear them 7 days. Take the ram for the ordination and cook the meat in a sacred place at the entrance of the tent of meeting. Aaron and his sons are to eat the meat of the ram and the bread that is in the basket. They are to eat these offerings by which atonement was made for their ordination and consecration. But no one else may eat them because they are sacred. And if any of the meat of the ordination, ram, or any other bread is left over till morning, burn it up. It must not be eaten because it is sacred. Do for Aaron and his sons everything I've commanded you, taking 7 days to ordain them. Sacrifice a bull each day as a sin offering to make atonement. Purify the altar by making atonement for it and anoint it to consecrate it. For 7 days, make atonement for the altar and consecrate it. Then the altar will be most holy, and whatever touches it will be holy. 7 days. Whole ritual was gone through every day but 7 days. What do you think that's about?
I think that the 7 days signifies the fact that every day is holy.
Okay, because there were seven, there's the image in Exodus, in Genesis, of the world being made in 7 days, yeah? So every part, every day, every all of life is holy. I think also it emphasizes, again, the seriousness of sin. This whole process of producing a priesthood out of sinful people is not something that is easy, that can be done just like that. It took Jesus to come in our world to die on the cross, for his life to be shed for us to have forgiveness of sins. It's not cheap, it's not easy, it's expensive. It's free, but it's not cheap. Do you understand? It's free, it's God's unmerited favor towards us, God's grace towards us, God's mercy towards us. It's free, but it's not cheap. It was bought at a price. And here we see that here, 7 days. And it is about, as you say, the whole of life, the complete cycle of life, the 7 days going back to the 7 days, image of 7 days of creation back in Genesis. This phrase, by which atonement was made, is the word atonement, is it links back to that the name of the cover of the covenant box. Do you remember a few weeks ago we looked at the making of the covenant box, what old versions called the Ark of the Covenant? And remember looking at that, the cover, which was not made of wood but was made of gold. And it the image there of covering over, it had blood poured on it to cover over sin. And here again, atonement is this same thing. It's about sin being covered over by the shed blood. In the Old Testament, the image of rams and lambs, but of course all of that is pointing forward to the reality of Jesus dying on the cross. And the altar itself needing purifying, because it'd been made by sinful human hands. Altars prior to this had always been made from unhewn rock, rock that human beings had not altered in any way. This is the first time an altar was made, and it was made by sinful human beings, like us. So it had to be consecrated itself for it to be fit for God to use. Okay, let's come on to this last section, and then we're going to do some wider work around this. So verse 38, down to the end of the chapter. This is what you are to offer on the altar regularly each day. Two lambs a year old, offer one in the morning and the other at twilight. With the first lamb, offer a tenth of an ephah of fine flour mixed with a quarter of a hin of oil from pressed olives and a quarter of a hin of wine as a drink offering. Sacrifice the other lamb at twilight with the same grain offering and its drink offering as in the morning, a pleasing aroma, an offering made to the Lord by fire. For the generations to come, this burnt offering is to be made regularly at the entrance to the tent of meeting before the Lord. There I'll meet you and speak to you. There I'll meet with the Israelites, and the place will be consecrated by my glory. So I, says God, will consecrate the tent of meeting and the altar, and will consecrate Aaron and his sons to serve me as priests. Then I will dwell among the Israelites and be their God. They will know that I am the Lord their God, who brought them out of Egypt so that I might dwell among them. I am the Lord their God. There are two things here which strike me out of these verses. Andy touched on one earlier on. The life of a priest, the daily life, was mundane. Every day, morning and evening, exactly the same offering done in exactly the same way. And that's the central part of the Old Covenant. In fact, they were still doing this in Jesus' day. The time of the daily sacrifice you find referred to in the New Testament. Well, this is what's being talked about here, the morning and evening sacrifice. All that way through being done, right until the time of the destruction of the temple, just after the close of the writing of the New Testament. And today, do you remember, we read at the beginning, 1 Peter chapter 2, how often do we make sacrifices today, according to that passage we read earlier on? Are you listening? What was the word used? No, it wasn't the living sacrifice. In the passage I read in 1 Peter, what was the term that was used about our sacrifices that priests make? How often? You can turn back if you want to. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 5 and 9. I want you to see the connection here, because all of this is joined together. We still, as priests, we still make sacrifices. How often? Daily. Oh, now there's a coincidence. They're doing daily sacrifices, morning and evening. Here are we as priests, we're doing sacrifices daily. And the sacrifices now, though, have changed. What are they called? Did you kill a lamb this morning? Spiritual. It's now spiritual sacrifices. So it isn't a physical lamb that we are making. And of course, it isn't sacrifice for sin either for us. But it is about us daily making spiritual sacrifices. So what does that mean? Spiritual lambs, we spiritually cut their throat and spirit. Now, what does it mean? This is part of our daily job. You're all priests, yeah? You all put your hand up earlier on, yeah? So what does this daily sacrifice mean for you? Say again? Confession of sins. Yeah, it's more than that. It includes that. It's that and. Is your hand up or are you just scratching? It's like an auction here. It's dangerous to scratch, yeah.
This is the whole thing about taking up the cross every day.
It's, yes. It's taking up your cross. Remember Jesus said, you take up your cross every day, about dying to self. Taking up the cross is a symbol of death, yes? And it's a symbol of laying down our lives for God, yeah? Which we do how often? Every day. It's part of our daily sacrifice. Okay, so what else does that involve? Let's spell that out a bit. Let's unpack that a moment. You're absolutely right with that. Do you want to say something else?
Just that he's putting others first and doing, it's a bit corporate, but doing what Jesus would do, which is putting others first.
It's putting other people first. It's doing what Jesus would do. Yeah, what else is involved here?
In a similar way to the priests being anointed with the blood, is for us to daily commit our listening to God, commit our actions, and commit our directions to Him.
Yeah, it's doing all those things, that the committing of life's actions, listening and direction to God. There's more, yes.
Communicating with God every day, praying and listening to Him.
Listening to God and praying. Praying is really important, because praying was an important part of the role of the priest. And who knows that sometimes prayer is not easy. Okay, sometimes prayer is a sacrifice, isn't it? Sometimes you just don't feel like it, do you? And yet there are all this world around us that we are called to pray for. We're commanded to pray for. And that is part of our ministry as priests, and that is part of our daily sacrifice. Very good.
It's living a crucified life.
Living a crucified life, yes. Our life laid down to God, yes.
Make a commitment with Jesus.
Making a commitment with Jesus every day, yeah. Tony?
So fasting as well, fasting, that's...
Fasting, yeah, very good. Okay, last three people, I think. Linda?
In those days, they did a physical sacrifice, but now, by accepting what Jesus did for us, we don't actually have to do a physical sacrifice.
Yep. So we don't make a physical sacrifice today, yeah, very good. Yeah, Hannah?
Renewal of our minds daily, let us live our holy lives. And be sensitive to the Holy Spirit in order to do the work.
Yeah. Daily renewing of our minds. That's a part of getting all that garbage and stuff out of our minds. So our minds given wholly over to God. Yes. Last one.
Priests interceded, and we have to intercede on behalf.
What does intercede mean, Timmy? It's a good word. I agree with the word, but some people may not know what that word means.
Being the bridge for other people.
Being the bridge for other people. I like that. So we're actually praying for other people. We are being the bridge. It's again being the place where heaven meets earth, isn't it? For other people, we pray for other people. We are the bridge for other people and God. Very good. And then there is this amazing promise that God would meet with, would speak with, would dwell among, and He would be their God. Isn't that exciting? You know, we take this for granted. You know, us happy, clappy, charismatic Christians, you know, that God was here this morning, spoke to people this morning, touched people's lives this morning. Most of you today at some point you'll have heard God speak to you or guide you or know God's presence with you. And you just take it for granted. As though, well, you know, another day. But it actually is awesome. It's amazing. This God who created the whole of the universe, who holds it in His hands, keeps it in being, took the trouble to speak to you this morning and to be here with us this morning and make His presence felt among us this morning. It is awesome. Absolutely amazing. Amen?
Amen.
It was amazing for them, but it was always God's intention, always God's intention to dwell among His people. And for them to be His people and Him to be their God. Let's think a bit more about ourselves. I want us to, in a moment, to read a passage. I'm going to read a passage from Hebrews. But this service here, as someone else I was reading this week, is about personal dedication. It's about moral separation from sin, separation to service, about God's revelation. One of the people, I mentioned him earlier on, Motier, who I've been reading this week, he points out that all of the components here in this ordination, consecration of these priests are true for us today. We are cleansed from our sins by Jesus' shed blood. We are clothed in his righteousness. We are anointed. We are set apart for ministry. We are called to. We come under Christ's saving work. This is just an Old Testament picture of our reality. Turn with me to Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10. We're finishing with this passage. It's page 1208 if you've got one of our church Bibles. And by that will, we have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Day after day, every priest stands and performs his religious duties. Again and again, he offers the same sacrifices which can never take away sins. But when this priest, Jesus, had offered for all time one sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God. And since that time, he waits for his enemies to be made his footstool. Because by one sacrifice, he has made perfect forever those who are being made holy. Us, who put your hands up this morning. The Holy Spirit also testifies to us about this. Firstly, he says, this is the covenant I will make with them. After that time, says the Lord, I will put my laws in their hearts. I will write them on their minds. Then he adds, their sins and lawless acts I will remember no more. And where these have been forgiven, there is no longer any sacrifice for sin. Therefore, in the light of all of this that we've been learning this morning, therefore, we have confidence to enter the most holy place. That's the Holy of Holies. That's where the covenant box was. That's what the place that was covered by the curtain that the high priest once went into once a year. No one else went in at any other time. That was the place where the curtain was torn in two from top to bottom when Jesus died on the cross. Therefore, we, you and me, have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus. Amen. Amen. By a new and living way opened for us through the curtain. That is his body. His body was broken on the cross. The curtain was ripped in two from top to bottom. And since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled. Remember, Aaron and the priests were sprinkled with the blood, consecrated, made clean. Here it is for us. Our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience. Theirs was on the outside. Ours is on the inside. It's our minds, our hearts, our consciences being cleansed by the blood of Jesus shed for us, having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. Whoa, isn't that amazing? It's always been God's intention, right the way back in the beginning, all the way back in Exodus. It was God's intention. It didn't work with the old covenant. Jesus came, and all of that that we've seen promised and anticipated now, today, is a reality for us. We, you and me, we can go into the most holy place, into God's presence. Isn't that amazing? We, sinful people, you and me. Ordinary people, sinful people, people that have made mistakes. We, because Jesus' blood was shed for us, we're cleansed not just on the outside, but on the inside. And we can go right into God's presence. And we have a great high priest who intercedes, who prays, who is the bridge for us. And his name is Jesus. What have we learnt this morning? We are all called to be priests, cleansed from our sin, anointed and ordained by God to daily make spiritual sacrifices and to declare his praises. Amen. Amen. Let's stand together. I want to pray for you as we finish this morning. Just before I pray out loud, I want you just to think, to call into your minds the reality for you today. You hear full-time Christian ministers. You hear priests to the Most High God. Been invited into his presence, the most holy place, holy above any other space in the universe. You're invited. And the reason you, sinful people, can come into this place is because Jesus shed blood makes you clean. Not just on the outside, but on the inside. So before I pray for you, you might want to say thank you to God for that awesome, awesome privilege that you have this morning. Father God, thank you. Thank you. Thank you for inviting us into your presence. Thank you for the privilege we have as your priests. Thank you for the fact that we can come into that most holy place and you meet with us. Father God, thank you. And Father God, I want to pray for all of us here that this week, tomorrow, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, all this week, wherever we are, whatever we're doing, at work, at home, at school, at college, with our neighbours, in the supermarket, walking down the street, in the gym, going to the park, wherever we are, we remember that we are full-time your priests. That we are the temple for the people around us. We're the place where heaven touches earth for the people around us. In this needy world with people who are in darkness, people who are in despair, people who are in difficulties of one sort and another, who do not know you, who are separated from you. Father God, help us to remember at every moment, in every place, that we are the place where heaven touches earth. Help us to minister as priests this week. To make those daily spiritual sacrifices as we pray, as we share your word with people around us, wherever we are, whatever we're doing, to be doing it for you, making a difference for you. Father God, thank you for the privilege that you have consecrated us, ordained us, anointed us as your priests, your holy people, a nation for you. In Jesus' name, amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom? Our postcode is UB69UA. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.